Le Corbusier was born in 1887. He died just 7 years ago. His architecture was tough and sensual. His personality was bitter and seductive. Contradiction was the essence of his life and work. His architecture conveyed the austerity of a monk's life. He told his wife, "In a life dedicated to struggle, there is no place for children." In tonight's program, we look at some of the revolutionary buildings the man designed. Buildings that were to make him the most influential architect of the 20th century. At the age of 63, Le Corbusier produced one of the most revolutionary buildings ever to appear on the architectural scene. This pilgrimage chapel at Ronchamp in Western France. Every building Le Corbusier designed caused a sensation. None more than this chapel at Ronchamp, completed in 1955. He was besieged by journalists. They caught him outside by the altar of pilgrimage. One American journalist demanded to know his religious beliefs. "Monsieur Le Corbusier, in the name of the manager of the Chicago Tribune, answer this question. Was it necessary to be a Catholic to build this chapel?" He told them, "Get the hell out of here." Le Corbusier was agnostic. He spurned traditions. He attacked customs, whether they were architectural styles or habits of thought. The style of architecture confused not only journalists, but modern architects as well. Where they had expected the modern steel and glass, they found primitive materials and rough forms and bold curves. There were a few traditional images of the church if you knew where to look. The keys of St. Peter and the image of clouds were painted on the door by Le Corbusier, his only concessions to conventional worship. The roof didn't symbolize, as people thought, praying hands or a monk's hood. Le Corbusier said it was based on the shell of a crab, for structural reasons, not religious ones. A crab shell was both beautiful and structurally sound, a fact of natural law. Towers, like enormous ice cream scoops, were beautifully functional, catching the light and funneling it down into the chapel below. The inside of these light scoops also act as great amplifiers, sending the monks' chants reverberating throughout the chapel. Only 50 people are allowed to sit down. Le Corbusier felt meditation and quiet were enhanced by keeping people on their toes. When you're on your toes, you lean slightly forward because the floor slopes and you find yourself impelled towards the altar. The walls lean in slightly. The roof, instead of soaring up like every traditional church, plunges downward. The 10 feet thick south wall, faced with sprayed concrete, is blasted away into a series of deeply recessed niches. The glass isn't stained, it's painted. Painted by Le Corbusier, with slogans and designs which he, rather than the church, found significant. The walls slope inward. The dark, heavy roof pushes down. The space should be oppressive and cramped, but the thin strip of sun that underpins the roof, the weird handling of light, dissolve all sense of weight. This chapel was the work of an agnostic and the prophet of modern technology. Polished steel and the right angle. It was one of the few commissions Le Corbusier ever got built. At the end of his life, he was a tired and bitter man, but he loved to dramatize his struggle. Town planning expresses the life of an era, he said. Architecture reveals its spirit. Some men have original ideas and are kicked in the ass for their pains. 7 schemes for Algiers were rejected, unpaid. So were plans for Stockholm, Moscow, Buenos Aires, Montevideo, Rio de Janeiro, Paris, Zurich, Antwerp, Barcelona, New York, Bogota. And then the Unité at Marseille. 5 years of storm, spite and uproar followed. Despicable, ugly. To Le Corbusier, this conflict was life. He was a born revolutionist. As a youth, he followed the revolutionary style of his time, Jugendstil, youth style, the hippie style of 1900, found in nature and its vegetable forms the only truths worth following. Le Corbusier was born in La Chaux-de-Fonds, the Swiss watchmaking town in the Jura Mountains. His family included revolutionists and heretics, a small persecuted sect which had to live by its wits alone, fleeing suppression and making watches. At art school, he made studies from nature and incorporated these studies into his first building. It was in the Art Nouveau style. He was 17 and a half when he built it. Pitched roofs, organic decoration, all this he was to violently reject. At 21, the rejection started. He learned the revolutionary lessons of engineering, the Eiffel Tower, from the famous Parisian architect, Auguste Perret. He saw a new industrial style in Germany emerging in the monumental factories designed by Peter Behrens. What was later to be known as functionalism and the international style was already a reality here in Berlin in 1910. Le Corbusier settled in Paris in 1917, and here he started a love-hate relationship with the city that lasted all his life. Paris is a place of champions and gladiators, he said. Paris is paved with corpses. Paris is an assembly of cannibals who establish the dogma of the moment. Paris is a selectioner. In fact, Le Corbusier himself was almost selected out. He started a brick factory which went bankrupt in 1921. Here he formulated his doctrine of purism, or how the selection process produces pure, beautiful forms, such as those found in American grain silos, or the long, clean lines of ocean liners. He used these images to promote purism on the cover of his book, Vision Architecture. This book, Towards a New Architecture, became the most powerful tract of the 20th century. These pictures in the book illustrated the slogans that resounded from chapter to chapter. A great epoch has begun. There is a new spirit. It is a spirit of construction and of synthesis guided by a clear conception. We claim in the name of the steamship, of the airplane, and of the motor car, the right to health, logic, daring, harmony, perfection. What gave his manifesto such force was the discovery of a new morality behind the engineer's approach. The precision of machines, their clean lines, and mathematical proportions. In apparent contradiction, he used classical architecture to illustrate these formal rules. On a photo of the Porte Saint-Denis and on the Petit Trianon at Versailles, he drew proportional lines, The modern sentiment is a spirit of geometry, he said. His first house in the modern style was based on this geometry. The villa at Vaucresson, 1922, was a classical box, stripped of its decoration, a petit trianon for the little man. Here at Pessac, Le Corbusier had his first opportunity to try out his architecture as mass housing. The white international style was put to the social use for which it was always intended. The house for the worker would be mass-produced, just as the automobile. Another of the rare opportunities Le Corbusier had for low-cost housing was built in Germany in 1927 as part of a model settlement. It illustrated beautifully his slogan that the house is a machine for living in. Looking like a long white ocean liner with its open decks and smooth detailing, it is built from mass-produced reinforced concrete units. It illustrates another of his slogans, what he called the 5 points of the new architecture. Point one, the reinforced concrete frame allowed the building to be raised off the ground on stilts to leave this free for traffic circulation. Point two, the concrete frame allowed each inhabitant to move interior partitions around at will. Point three, it allowed the ribbon window, which gave equal illumination on the interior. Point four, it allowed the architect to compose the facade any way he wished. And finally, point five, the concrete frame allowed gardens on the roof. All this was shown with the logic of a geometrical proposition. One couldn't resist the new architecture any more than the law of gravity. The perfect embodiment of these principles was the Villa Savoy in Poissy, near Paris, built in 1930. Here was a vindication of Le Corbusier's definition of architecture. Architecture is the masterly, correct, and magnificent play of masses brought together in light. Cubes, cones, spheres, cylinders, or pyramids are the great primary forms, the most beautiful forms. The image of this white slab, hovering above earth on slender supports, caused a sensation. People saw it as an alien spacecraft, the invasion of a mechanical race which was too unnatural to have close contact with the ground. All it could do was float gently above the flat green field. But for those sympathetic to modern architecture, this was it. As you enter on the ground floor, you are involved in a magnificent symphony of pure forms and shapes. The straight inclined ramp, the curved staircase, accentuated by its black handrails, the stark vertical columns. But there was something forbidding about this purity. No warm color or fabrics. The feel of a hospital, the sound of the laboratory, the cleanliness of the operating table. The lifestyle seemed to be that of a Swedish health camp. Le Corbusier set out the ideals for everyday life in his Manual of the Dwelling. Demand bare walls in your bedroom, your living room, and your dining room. Demand a bathroom looking south. Make it one of the largest rooms in the house. The most up-to-date fittings with a shower bath and gymnastic appliances. One wall to be entirely glazed, opening, if possible, onto a balcony for sun baths. And what alien race was supposed to inhabit this machine for living in? Actually, it was built as a weekend retreat, an escape from Paris for Madame Savoy, the wife of a banker. such luxurious villas are another contradiction in Le Corbusier's character, since he really intended his architecture for the poor. He believed that the poor wouldn't understand his work, so he sought out the rich. Here at Poissy, one can imagine long weekend house parties of the rich, the famous, and the enlightened patrons of modern art. They would perambulate throughout the house, onto the open terrace, where they would be set off by the architecture, much as figures in a Renaissance stage set. But it was not isolated monuments he was fighting for. He wanted to revolutionize all aspects of society. Le Corbusier went to New York in 1935. He already knew what he was going to say when he was met off the boat by a group of journalists. He told them, "Your skyscrapers are too small and they are too close together." The American press was outraged. "Frenchman finds our skyscrapers too small," they reported, forgetting to add the important point that he said they were also too close together to let in light and air and allow circulation. What Le Corbusier wanted to do was design a city like New York from scratch. The chaos, noise, squalor, and brutality of New York appalled him, although he was, like many people, captivated by its dynamism and power. The traffic congestion horrified him the most. In it, he saw the great waste of capitalism, technology run amok, pollution, road accidents, endless hours wasted in commuting between suburbs and city. To counter this, he proposed the city in the park. He wanted to see these skyscrapers of New York set in an English landscape garden. Le Corbusier had analyzed the growing pangs of the modern city in diagrammatic form. The city, he observed, had grown as a series of concentric rings, which impeded traffic circulation and resulted in lost commuting time. The new city would look like this. Le Corbusier made this design for a contemporary city for 3 million people in 1922. 60-story high glass and steel skyscrapers, and set idyllically in a spacious park. A striking image which modern planners have found all but irresistible. Le Corbusier admired the geometric clarity of the 16th century Place des Vosges in Paris, the result of a strong municipal act of the kind essential for the large-scale planning decisions he had in mind, like the 19th century road systems through Paris. There were to be no more corridor streets, of the kind he hated in New York, streets which had grown too narrow because of land values and speculation. Once they had served a purpose as pedestrian paths, but now they were congested, noisy, and filthy, like a biological organ which had outlived its purpose. "Cut it out, it disgusts us," he wrote. In his drawings, he pilloried the traditional city plan and its chaotic and muddled traffic circulation. The alternative in his city for 3 million was to put underground 7 different layers of traffic circulation. At the bottom would be the suburban trains, then different levels for lorries and fast cars, then parking, and on the roof, an airport. The advantage of bringing together the railway station, airport, and car is obvious today, when so much time is lost in traveling between them. The image underlying Le Corbusier's planning was biological, not mechanical. He saw the functions of a city like organs of the body. The business center was the stomach, and the blood system was a type of traffic. He said this in the 1930s, and his drawings of the time have now become a reality for many of us. But the analogy can be taken too far. and this is precisely what Le Corbusier and other modern architects did in the 1930s. On board a ship sailing from Marseille to Athens in 1933 was a valuable cargo of architects. CIAM. The letters stand for Congress of International Modern Architects. They met on this ship because their intended place of meeting, Moscow, was ruled out by an act of Stalin. On this Mediterranean cruise, far from the ills of the city, these architects got to work comparing the plans of 35 major cities. Not only architects, but planners, art historians, and painters were there as well. The dominant role was played by an architect, planner, and painter all rolled into one, Le Corbusier. The conference fell under his spell and produced the Charter of Athens, the new Bible of city planning, which said that the modern city was dying of sclerosis, of blood congestion, and that the only way to save it was to hack up its various organs, its four basic functions. Purify them and separate them so they didn't contaminate each other. The Athens Charter was taken up by city planning legislation around the world. As usual, Le Corbusier perfected the principles in one of his own plans, that for Namur, North Africa, 1936. Here, the four functions of a city are nicely removed from each other. One, the living area. Two, the work area, on the outskirts of the city. Three, the recreation area. Four, the circulation routes, connect them all together. Le Corbusier never built this city in North Africa. Like most of his city plans, it remained on paper. The image of the city in a park, of housing separated from industry, is very persuasive, but the reality can be very different. Any living city grows slowly. There isn't a sterile purification of parts, but a rich mixture of many functions, certainly more than four. This vast dormitory city of Sarcelles near Paris is given over solely to the function of living, if it can be called that, with a bit of parkland thrown in between, a monument to functional purification. The center of social life for the Frenchman is the bistro. This one is in the center of Paris and is where Le Corbusier had lunch almost every day for 4 years. It inspired his idea of how the worker should live. He said, it has a bar, the kitchen at the back. A balcony divides the place into two stories. The window at the front opens onto the street. One day one discovers it. And one sees that it is nothing but the embodiment of an architectural mechanism, which can serve as a basis for the organization of a dwelling cell. This bistro appeared transformed as his pavilion of the new spirit at the Paris Exhibition of Decorative Arts of 1925. On the balcony of the bistro, there was now a bedroom, which overlooked the large double-height living room. Every inch proclaimed the same message, a revolution in art, architecture, and daily living. Even a revolution in city planning, for now, each cell, with its terrace of greenery, could be plugged into a gigantic megastructure to make up a city of hanging gardens. Just as Le Corbusier got his idea of the cell from a bistro, he got the idea of plugging them into a megastructure from watching wine bottles being plugged into a rack. It wasn't until after the Second World War and the acute housing shortage that Le Corbusier had the opportunity to realize these ideas on a large scale. Here in Marseille, on the Mediterranean coast, he finally had the chance to build his plug-in megastructures, his bottles of living units pushed into a wine rack. The great advantages of this were obvious. Economy achieved by mass production, and acoustic isolation achieved by separating each cell. The inhabitants have actually complained because there isn't the usual noise between apartments which they are used to. This unité d'habitation, or unity of living functions, was built between 1947 and 1952. This is Le Corbusier's favorite image, the ocean liner plowing through the countryside of Provence. It dominates the landscape for miles. Not only can one see each apartment cell or villa clearly marked on the exterior, but also the dark horizontal of the shopping center halfway up. This vertical city for 1,600 people is as comprehensible as a horizontal city. Each anonymous cell is personalized by the inhabitant. Le Corbusier saw the housewife as the captain of the French family, and her kitchen, underneath the balcony and in the center of the apartment, as the command post for keeping watch on the children. On the seventh floor, in place of the outside street corridor of usual cities, is an interior street which contains a supermarket, hotel, restaurant, post office, hairdresser, bar, indeed almost every function of a city street. The effect is rather like the commercial center on board an ocean liner. Here, a housewife can find everything she needs in an instant, without leaving the ship. She can shop on impulse, informally, in her curlers and slippers, without feeling ill at ease. On the apartment floors, there is a long interior street, dark and in strong contrast with the roof. If Le Corbusier puts the streets in the air, he seems even more odd when he puts the piazza on the roof. At one side is a gymnasium, and at the other, an open-air theater with a concrete screen for projecting movies. There is also a nursery and a running track. The nursery school has a paddling pool, and the roof piazza is completed by a maze and an outcrop of rocks. Children can play in the sun, safely removed from the danger of the street, the noise and fumes of cars, supervised easily by an instructor, while their father sweats off his excess weight on the track. Even Le Corbusier himself used to run around this track at 6 a.m. when he visited the building. Le Corbusier said with pride, "The roof and landscape are worthy of Homer." Le Corbusier got his first opportunity to design a whole new city in India, where Nehru commissioned him to lay out the capital city of the Punjab, Chandigarh, started in 1952 and still building today. This commission brought out the greatest contradictions in Le Corbusier. Here was a Frenchman designing a capital city, the national symbol and showplace for India, a non-Western culture. Here, the prophet of technology was designing for the most primitive resources. The cultural traditions of India are filling out and distorting the basic plan of Le Corbusier, as he predicted. He felt that the architect should provide only an essential organization that worked well, after which individuals, with their specific desires and customs should fill in the parts. Le Corbusier insisted that although various types of housing were to be built, there was to be no class system built into the plan. The governors of Chandigarh and the rich live in international-style villas, Villa Savoys for the little MPs, and go to receptions at the sleek modern country club. Though there are still class differences, at least there are not the teeming slums of Bombay and Calcutta, and the Indians are proud of that. The Indians are also proud of the city centre, the business area with its banks and administrative buildings, which to a Westerner look monotonous, grey and empty. The Indians regard it as dignified and clean, a mark of maturity which reminds them of New Delhi, its grand, flat expanses of space which characterized British imperial planning at its best. Le Corbusier has applied here his concept of architectural control, the idea of individual shops placed into a structure which keeps a certain regularity, rather like the Rue de Rivoli in Paris, or parts of George in London. Unfortunately, the Indians have not interpreted or modified this structure as Le Corbusier intended. They haven't given it different height spaces or surface treatments, so it still appears too controlled, too rigid. Another example of a good intention not yet fulfilled. Using the biological analogy, Le Corbusier naturally referred to the business center as the stomach of Chandigarh. According to his theory of functional separation, the stomach should be removed from the heart or recreation area, which consists of an artificial lake made by damming up the Sukhna Sea. Some of the recreation includes the colonial traditions, but the intention of Le Corbusier was to provide a quiet, secluded spot away from the city for walks and meditation. He persuaded the officials to ban all power boats and build low into the ground, submerging the architecture by vegetation. The supreme function of Chandigarh is not the heart or the stomach of the city, but the head, the government quarter. Here is monumental planning on a heroic scale, much too heroic for the poor officials who have to bicycle from one large monument to the other in a climate which is oppressively hot. As so often, Le Corbusier has put his work on a grandiose scale, using the mountains as a backdrop. He wished people to use these monuments with the reverence and awe that are inspired by traveling across wide open spaces, an experience he had climbing up the Acropolis to the Parthenon. It was meant to shock people out of their usual habits, to overwhelm their petty differences. Under this tower meets the General Assembly of Parliament. The delegates sit surrounded by weird shapes called acoustic clouds, which cut down the echo and noise and provide provide something for the delegates to think about. The daily course of the sun follows the path of this circular shape. Each delegate is given a microphone so that he can intercede in debate and, at least in theory, make parliamentary democracy a reality. The entrance hall to the General Assembly is an open forum where delegates talk informally between meetings, an overpowering space pierced by dozens of plain, slim cylinders, a far cry from the Victorian Gothic of the Mother of Parliaments. The locals have come to accept the architecture. The large pools, designed, in theory, to double the visual height of the buildings, are often used for more immediate ends. More formally, the delegates can escape the heat under the huge U-shaped entrance canopy. A good bicycle ride away from the Secretariat is the legal wing of Chandigarh, housed in 8 high courts, placed beneath a gigantic parasol of concrete which shields them from the sun and monsoon rains. Air circulates freely through openings, and the concrete sunshades cut the glare and solar heat. Because of political difficulties, Chandigarh will probably never be completed as Le Corbusier wished. This, his only city plan to be commissioned, was built with primitive technology, was built for the 21st century, and was built for a non-Western culture. Corbusier's architecture was created at great personal effort. 12 hours a day for 50 years, he labored over design, painting, and city planning. His office was located in the dingy corridors of a converted Jesuit cloister in Paris. His mornings were usually spent in painting and drawing for sculpture and tapestry. He said of this artistic endeavor, "I think if one grants a certain significance to my work as an architect, it is to this secret labor that one must attribute its profound value." Because his art was never accepted at the level of his friend Picasso, he felt great sadness and at times refused to show his work to anyone. His painting was, in one sense, as revolutionary as his architecture. His doctrine of purism introduced the idea that the pure forms of everyday objects and pure forms of machines had a factor in common which was beautiful and which had escaped all other artists who were worried by the banal content of such objects as glasses, bottles, plates, books, and pipes. These objects showed how simple the good life could be. And like the anonymous ocean liner or airplane, they were the result of mechanical selection and were drawn with the precision of an engineer. Later, he changed. He became more interested in women than machines. Yet something of his geometric interest remained, their arms and shoulders are almost machine-like cylinders. Le Corbusier had a partiality for fat women. Their bodies are cut up into a sequence of bold curves, jagged outlines, and aggressive shapes. Breasts become haunting eyes. In fact, the curving forms of this painting, Alma Rio 36, were reflected in Le Corbusier's town planning and architecture. The sculptural forms seen on the rooftops of his buildings often had their birth in these paintings. Alma Rio 36 was one of his favorite paintings. It hung in his Paris house, a backdrop to the good, simple life. The life filled with everyday, purest objects. The life epitomized by monks who came to him for his most characteristic building, the Dominican monastery of La Tourette. It seems strange that what Le Corbusier considered to be a most successful building should be designed for an ancient rather than a modern institution, for the closed society of a monastery rather than the open society of, say, a university. But this just underlines yet one more of the contradictions in his life. As a young man of 20, Le Corbusier had been impressed by the community life he found at various monasteries he visited. They contained such a healthy relationship between the individual and group. The isolated cell with direct view to nature, and the communal functions such as dining, prayer, and study, they became his ideal for the future modern community. The monasteries Le Corbusier had seen as a youth also contained the striking relation of simple forms set against a violent nature, an aspect which Le Corbusier has heightened by splitting up walls and knocking through holes to achieve a dramatic glimpse of the countryside. The interior of the church is stark and austere, and like Corbusier's ancestors, Calvinist in feeling. No decoration, only a wedge of light, a straight black line of the floor, a rectangular altar, and reflected colors on the walls. Le Corbusier told the monks to avoid all decoration and conventional symbolism. Monks take their visitors on conducted architectural tours. They love the building and love pointing out what they had learned from Le Corbusier to call volumes perceived in movement. The monks were the most appreciative and understanding clients that Le Corbusier ever designed. This is a religious architecture of an agnostic who worships natural laws. For those who can read a wealth of meaning in a pure surface and in the drama of basic forms, it is full of significance. For others, it just seems empty and brutal. Most of his architectural schemes and city plans were destined to remain on paper, cardboard models gathering dust among his personal belongings. He lost thousands of commissions and was often never paid for his work. He never achieved his primary goal, to bring harmony to industrial civilization, to build the city for 10 million in the park. Hence his bitterness. Sometimes I despair. Men are so stupid that I'm glad I'm going to die. All my life, people have tried to crush me. First, they called me a dirty engineer, then a painter who tried to be an architect, then an architect who tried to paint, then a communist, then a fascist. Luckily, I've always had an iron will. Though timid as a youth, I forced myself to cross Rubicons. I am the boxer type. The bitterness was always very explicit. The extraordinary thing is that the bitterness is shown with joy, with the pleasure that comes from a good fight. This is the supreme contradiction, and the one that helps explain Le Corbusier. Why should an architect accentuate conflict, which will only scare away clients, unless he believed these battles were the essence of positive action, that pain, mistakes, and conflict must necessarily come along with the creation of new values? A tragic view of the creative situation. In later life, part of his summers were spent at Cap Martin in southern France, living like a hermit alone in the natural landscape. Work usually started at 7 in the morning and continued through the day. He lived in a small wooden cabin, a monk's cell for himself, and enjoyed the simple values for which his life had been fought. Appropriately, he spent his last hours here, and died while swimming in the Mediterranean on a late summer's afternoon in August 1965. A fitting end for a man whose natural religion was founded on such primary values as sun, space, and green.
Next tonight, the story of seven children from right round the world, all born in 1992 when the Earth Summit took place in Rio. Stay with us.